Hello everyone, and welcome to Math 131a, Week 9, Lecture 2. Last time we have proved a number of results about differentiation. So we have proved several differentiation theorems, including Fermat theorem, Rolle's theorem, and the mean value theorem. We have proved the chain rule, and we have also established some properties of the exponential function, in particular that it has derivatives of all orders. Today we move on to a new chapter. We begin discussing integration. This is a very important operation and idea, which in many ways can be viewed as the inverse operation to the differentiation operation. In this course, we will develop Darboux integral. You might have seen a variant of it, which is called Riemann integral, which is typically used in freshman calculus, etc. But here we will develop Darboux integral, which is a bit more abstract and relies on various results we have obtained about supremum, etc. This provides a more efficient and transparent way to develop integration, while it still has all the same features. And in fact, it actually gives precisely the same operation of integration. Now, there are many, many applications of integration. We will see, classically they're used to determine, for example, the area of a complicated shape, the shape under the graph of an integrable function. And also it is used to prove the fundamental theorem of calculus, which connects differentiation and integration, showing that these operations are inverse to each other. It is also worth mentioning that integrability of a function, which is a precise way to express that it's possible to define and meaningfully calculate the integral of this function, is a global property. So we already saw that continuity and differentiability of a function are local properties, these are properties which depend on a certain condition which happens at a small neighborhood of any given point. So the important thing is that integrability is not a local property and rather a global property. So it depends on the behavior of the function on its domain as a whole, as opposed to just its behavior locally at every single point of the domain. So this is an important fact which has to be factored into the theory of integration. Now, intuitively, integral is just an infinite variant of the summation operation, where it is infinite in the sense that we take the limit of a certain quantity which is approximated by finite sums in a better and better way. So the theory of limits is quintessential here as well. So let us begin by introducing the special kind of finite sums that we would like to consider in order to define integration. So namely, the so-called Darboux sums. So throughout our discussion, we fix a function f defined on the closed interval AB and taking values and the real numbers, which is bounded. So recall, this simply means that the set of values that the function takes on this interval is a bounded set of real numbers. Now we will be using the following notation. Given a set S, a subset of the interval AB, we define capital M of FS to be simply the supremum of the image of the function F, and little m of FS to be the infimum of the set of values that the function f takes on the set S inside its domain. Next, we define partitions. A partition of the interval AB is a finite set denoted as P consisting of the real numbers T0, T1, etc. up to Tn for some natural number n, such that we have that A is equal to the first element of the set, T0, which is smaller than T1, which is smaller than T2, etc., less than Tn, which is equal to the right end point of the interval B. So Tn is equal to B. In other words, if we draw a picture on the real line, assume we're given an interval AB, then a partition of this interval is any choice of an increasing finite sequence of points inside that interval, so that we necessarily have T0 gives the left hand point, Tn gives the right hand point, and the points in the partition are increasing. So this simply splits the interval into finitely many smaller intervals. We also define the size of the partition P to be P in vertical brackets, and we take it to be equal to N, so just the number of subintervals into which it is partitioned. Given a partition P of this form, we define the following real numbers associated to it. We let U of FP to be given by the sum over all K from 1 to N, M of F and the interval TK minus 1 TK multiplied by the length of the corresponding interval tk minus 1. Similarly, we define L of fp, which is exactly the same sum, but instead of capital M, we use small m. So little m of f, the interval tk minus 1 tk, multiplied by the length tk minus tk minus 1. These real numbers are called the upper or respectively the lower Darboux sum of F with respect to the partition P. Let us try to understand the geometric meaning of these two quantities. So we're given the interval AB on the real line and some function f defined on it and bounded. So let's draw the graph of the function f and assume that we pick a partition P, for example, into four pieces. So this is T0 equal to A, T1, T2, T3, and we have T4 equal to B. So in total we have partitioned the interval AB into four smaller intervals. Let's first consider the upper Darboux sum, U of FP. According to the definition, we have to look at each of these smaller intervals separately and determine the supremum and the infimum of the function restricted to that interval. So if we look at the first interval, let's say this one, the corresponding supremum of the values of the function is given by this value here. So the y-coordinate of this point is precisely m, capital M, of f and the interval t0, t1, this point here. We have to do the same operation for every other interval. So for the interval t1, t2, it's in fact corresponds to the same value.
Now we have the third interval, where now the supremum is achieved at this point, and for the last interval, the supremum is achieved at this point here. Now consider the quantity m f t k minus 1 t k multiplied by t k minus t k minus 1. What does this quantity represent? Well, let's say if we look at the last interval, the difference tk minus tk minus 1 corresponds to the length of this interval, and the first quantity corresponds to the y-coordinate giving the supremum of this function. Hence, this product can be viewed as the area of the rectangle with one side given by the length of the interval tk minus tk minus 1, and the other side given by the supremum of the values of the function on this interval. Hence, the product corresponds to the area of this rectangle. Repeating the same for each of the intervals, we hence obtain a rectangle . Now note that the whole figure, which is stuck between the x-axis and the graph of the function f, is contained in the union of these rectangles. What happens with the lower Darboux sum, L of fp? So in this case, we have to consider rectangles such that one side of the corresponding rectangle is still given by the interval tk minus tk minus 1, but now the other side of the rectangle is given by the infimum of the values of the function taken on this interval. Hence, the product corresponds to the area of this green rectangle here, which of course is contained in the greater rectangle. Now repeating this for each and every one of the four intervals into which we split the whole interval AB, we get these rectangles here, this rectangle here, and this rectangle here. So let's fill it in with green. Okay, and then the sum, so the actual lower sum, L of FP, corresponds to the sum of the areas of these four rectangles. This is the geometric meaning of the lower and upper Darboux sum. Now note that the lower Darboux sum is in fact contained, the geometric shape representing the lower Darboux sum is contained in the figure under the graph of the function. So given these two sums, from the picture one can expect a natural relation between these two sums. So namely, the area of the green figure should be smaller or less or equal to the area of the yellow figure, to the upper Darboux sum. So indeed, let's record this remark. Given a partition P, of the interval AB, we have the following inequalities. The infimum of the function f on the whole interval AB multiplied by the length of the interval AB is less or equal than the lower Darboux sum, which in turn is less or equal than the upper Darboux sum, which in turn is less or equal than the supremum of the function on the whole interval AB multiplied by the length of this interval, so B minus A. How do we get these additional inequalities? Well, let's look at the left-hand side. So this is the infimum of the function on the whole interval. Hence, we look at this rectangle. The area of this rectangle corresponds to this expression, the leftmost expression in the inequality. And for the rightmost expression, we have to look at the supremum of the function on the whole interval. So it's going to be here. And then we look at the area of the rectangle with the sides corresponding to the length of the whole interval AB, and the other side is given by the supremum of the values of the function on the whole interval. so it's certainly greater or equal than the supremum of the function on any of the smaller intervals. So then we see from the picture that these inequalities indeed obviously hold. You can also think about these shapes as a very crude approximation to the actual area of the shape under the graph of the function f. And the idea is then to look at partitions with more and more pieces. So we want to look at finer and finer partitions with the hope that they give finer and finer approximations to the area of the to the actual area of the figure under the graph of the function. So to be able to rigorously track the idea that these approximations get better and better when we refine the partition, we take more intervals in our partition, we need the so-called partition refinement lemma. We suppose that f is a function from the interval ab to the real numbers bounded, and we assume that p and q are partitions of the interval AB such that P is contained in Q. In other words, Q is a refinement of P. Right? So namely, every point that we have in P must also be in Q. So this means that every interval in P can only get subpartitioned further by intervals contained in Q. Given this assumption, we then can conclude that the lower Darboux sum of f with respect to P is less or equal than the lower Darboux sum of f with respect to Q, which is less or equal than the upper Darboux sum of f with respect to Q, which in turn is less or equal than the upper Darboux sum of f with respect to P. Proof. So the middle inequality we already know with respect to any partition, P or Q, doesn't matter. Hence, we don't need to prove it. Now, the first inequality is what we are going to do. So we're going to prove this inequality here. And the last inequality is completely similar, so we leave it as an exercise. Okay, so we give a proof of this first inequality here. We prove it by induction on the natural number d representing the difference between the size of q and the size of p. If d is equal to 0, then both partitions p and q have the same size, so it means there are no new points in q with respect to p. So this simply means that p is equal to q as sets, so they have the same points, t1 through tn. And if they're the same partition, then of course calculating the sum, the lower Darboux sum with respect to one of them is equal to the lower Darboux sum with respect to the other one, since they're literally the same partition. We have equality, so in particular, the inequality holds. For the inductive step, we suppose that d is greater or equal than 1, and that we already know the claim when the difference of the sizes of the partitions is at most d minus 1, greater or equal than 0. Now suppose we're given a pair of partitions P and Q, so that D is the difference of their sizes, so the size of Q minus the size of P, and we take a point T, which belongs to Q, but not to P. Since the size of Q, since D is assumed to be greater or equal than 1, we know that there is at least one point in Q, which is not in P. We denote it by T, and we define a new partition, Q prime, to consist of Q without this point T. then Q prime is also a partition of the interval AB. And we have that P is included in Q prime is included in Q. And moreover, if we look now at the difference of the sizes of Q prime and P, we know that this is equal to D minus 1, because we removed exactly one point. And similarly, the difference of the sizes between Q and Q prime is equal to 1. By the inductive hypothesis, it is enough to show that the lower Darboux sum of f with respect to q prime is less or equal than the lower Darboux sum of f with respect to q. So this basically corresponds to proving the d equal to 1 case of the proposition. So towards this, we can assume that Q prime consists of the points T0, etc., up to Tn, so that A is equal to T0 is less than T1, is less than T2, etc., less than Tn, which in turn is equal to B. And we can write the partition Q as T0. So we know there's just one extra point in Q. And we can assume it occurs at a certain position. Let's say we had the point between tk minus 1 and tk. So then we can write q as t0 through tk minus 1. Then we have this new point s. And then we have the remaining points. So tk through tn. So that tk minus 1 is smaller than s, is smaller than tk. For some particular k, from the least 1 through n.
Now we calculate the difference between the lower Darboux sum of f with respect to q and the lower Darboux sum of f with respect to q prime. If we write out both of the sums, it is easy to see that most of the terms will cancel out, except for the ones which involve s in them. Checking this carefully, we will see that what is left, the only things which don't obviously cancel out, are going to be of the following form. So we have little m of f t k minus 1 s multiplied by s minus t k minus 1 plus m of f, now we have the interval from s to t k, multiplied by tk minus s. So this comes from the first sum, where one interval got replaced by two, but we also have something left from the second sum, namely the interval tk minus 1 through tk. So we have m of f tk minus 1 through tk, multiplied by the length of this interval. So tk minus tk minus 1. Let's look carefully at this last expression. So we have that this is the same thing as m of f tk minus 1 tk multiplied by t k minus s plus s minus t k plus 1 minus 1, just splitting the last sum into two parts, which in turn is less or equal than m of f s t k multiplied by t k minus s. And this we get because, of course, the infimum of the function f on the interval s tk is less or equal than the infimum of the function f on the interval tk minus 1 tk, because in the second case we have a smaller interval. So any infimum which can be taken on this smaller interval also corresponds to some value that is taken on the bigger interval. So the infimum on the bigger interval can only go further down. Okay, so this corresponds to the first term. And for the second term, we get the same thing. So m of f t k minus 1 s times s minus t k minus 1. And the argument for this part is the same. The infimum on a bigger interval is less or equal than the infimum on any of the smaller subintervals. Okay, but then we see that this last term is less or equal, that has been subtracted, is less or equal than the sum of the first two terms. And hence the whole expression is greater or equal than zero. And this is precisely the inequality that we are trying to prove.
Next, we define the upper and the lower Darboux integrals. We define u of f, or the upper Darboux integral, to be the infimum of all the upper Darboux sums. So u of f p, where p is an arbitrary partition of the interval ab. Similarly, we define L of F to be the supremum of the set of all lower Darboux sums. So the supremum of all the real numbers L of F P, where P varies over all possible partitions of the interval AB. And we refer to this as the upper, respectively, the lower Darboux integral of the function f. As a corollary of the partition refinement lemma, we have the following. If p and q are arbitrary partitions of the interval AB, then we have that the lower Darboux sum L of FP is less or equal than the upper Darboux sum U of FQ. So the first one is with respect to P, the other one with respect to Q, no matter which partitions P and Q we are considering. And thus we have that the lower Darboux integral is less or equal than the upper Darboux integral of f. Proof. Suppose that p and q are arbitrary partitions of the interval ab, then the union p union q is a refinement of both P and Q. Yeah. So of course we have P is a subset of this union and Q is a subset of this union. Then, using the partition refinement lemma, in two different ways, first time with respect to the partition P and the partition P union Q, and the second time using it with respect to the partition Q and the partition P union Q, we get that the lower Darboux sum of F with respect to P is less or equal then the lower Darboux sum of F with respect to P union Q, which refines P. Now, this is less or equal than the upper Darboux sum of F with respect to P union Q, just because it's the same partition, so the lower sum is less or equal than the upper sum, which finally is less or equal than the upper Darboux sum of F with respect to Q. Once again, this is because P union Q is a partition that refines Q. But then it follows that if we look at the set of all the values of the lower Darboux sum with respect to P, where P is a partition of the interval AB, then it is less or equal than the set of all the upper Darboux sums of F with respect to Q, where Q is again an arbitrary partition of the interval AB. So remember, when we have two sets of real numbers, writing less or equal means that every element of the first set is less or equal than any element of the second set. And we have this from the previous paragraph. But now, if we have two sets in such situation, then the supremum of the set of the on the left-hand side is necessarily less or equal than the infimum of the set on the right-hand side. So we can conclude that the lower Darboux integral, L of F, which by definition is the supremum of this set, so the supremum of the set of all Darboux sums, such that P is a partition of the interval AB, is less or equal than the infimum of the set on the right-hand side, which is U of FQ. Q is a partition of the interval AB, which again by definition is equal to the upper Darboux integral of F. So we conclude that the lower Darboux integral is less or equal than the upper Darboux integral. And this concludes the proof of the corollary. Intuitively, the upper Darboux integral corresponds to approximating the area of the shape under the curve, under the graph of the function f from above, while the lower Darboux integral corresponds to approximating it from below by the areas of simpler shapes, just unions of rectangles. But in general, it would be hard to pick which one of these two gives a better approximation. And for this purpose, we will only consider the special situation when both of these integrals, in fact, give the same value. So both of these approximations from above and from below agree, in which case it's fair to say that this should give precisely the area of the curve, area of the shape under the graph of the function f, or the integral of this function. So we make this precise in the following definition. We say that the function f from the closed interval AB to R, which is moreover bounded, is integrable on this interval. Sometimes we might omit saying this explicitly. If we have that the lower Darboux integral of f is equal to the upper Darboux integral of f. In this case, we write the integral from a to b of f, or equivalently, the integral from a to b of f of x dx for this common value of these two integrals, upper and lower one,
In other words, we have that the integral of phase from B to F by definition is equal to the integral of A to from A to B of f of x dx, which is equal to L of f, which of course in this case is also equal to u of f. In this way we define the meaning of this integral symbol, and this value is now known as the Darboux integral of f. Or sometimes simply the integral of f. If we don't want to mention the name Darboux every time we refer to the integral. Now, if f from a, b to the real numbers is integrable, it will also be convenient to define that the integral from a to a, so the interval in this case is trivial, just the points between a and a, so just the point a itself. In this case, we define the integral to be equal to zero. And we also define the integral from b to a to be the minus the integral from a to b of f. So this is just a new piece of notation, right? Because the integral, the way we defined it, we only considered non-trivial integrals, so a strictly less than b. And now we also assign the meaning to the integral symbol in the situations when a is equal to b in the first case, or when, in fact, the lower parameter is greater than the upper parameter, then by definition we just say that this corresponds to inverting the sign. Let's consider a couple of examples which illustrate this new definition. Example 1. The constant function C, which we view as a function defined on the interval AB, and so that it is defined by c of x is equal to c for every for some choice of c, a real number, and every x in the interval ab. So we claim that the constant function is integrable and that the integral from a to b of this constant function c is simply equal to c times b minus a. To verify this, we need to check the definition of the integral for this special case. So to see this, note that for any non-empty set S, a subset of the interval AB, we have that both the supremum of the values of the function on this set S and the infimum of the values of the function on the set are both equal and are equal to the constant C, because there's only one value that this function takes. Thus, for any partition P of the interval AB, we have that the lower Darboux sum of this constant function C with respect to P is equal to the upper Darboux sum with respect to P and is equal simply to C times B minus A. So here we just have to write out the corresponding sums, and you see that for each small interval, the value, the supremum or the infimum of the function on that interval is always the same C. Hence, we have a sum of the form C times the length of the interval T1 minus T0, T2 minus T1, T3 minus T2, etc. But then we can take this multiple C outside of the sum, since it's the same in each of the summons, And the sum of the lengths of all the small intervals partitioning AB is just the length of the whole interval AB, so just B minus A. This is how we arrive at this expression. But then, of course, we get that the lower Darboux integral of the constant function C is equal to the upper Darboux integral, is equal to either of these two expressions, because they don't depend on P, so taking the supremum of the infimum with respect to P, we just get the same value, C times B minus A. So this gives the answer for the integral. Let's consider the second example. This time we consider the function f defined on the interval 0, b, given by f of x is equal to x squared. Then we claim that this function is integrable. And moreover, that the integral of f from 0 to b is equal to b cubed over 3. Let's calculate this directly from the definition without referring to the fundamental theorem of calculus, because we haven't established it yet. So for complicated functions, it starts getting a bit tedious, but for this one, as an example, which is might be useful for other situations, let's calculate it by hand. So assume we're given a partition, P, which consists of T0 equal to 0, less than T1, etc., less than Tn, which in turn is equal to B. We have the following for the upper Darboux sum. So we have U of Fp, by definition, is the sum over all k from 1 to n, the supremum of the values of the function. So this is the supremum of the set x of elements x square, where x is just an element of the corresponding interval, tk minus 1 tk, multiplied by the length of this interval. So tk minus tk minus 1. Now the sum can be simplified, so we can write it as the sum over all k from 1 to n, tk square times tk minus tk minus 1. This is, of course, because we know that the function is increasing on the corresponding interval, so the supremum would be achieved on the right end point of the corresponding interval, so just tk. So we take tk square. Now, if we choose a regular partition, where we have that tk is in fact equal to kb over n, so we choose a partition so that all intervals have the same length, then the sum of squares formula gives us that the upper Darboux sum, U of Fp, is equal to the sum over all k from 1 to n, k square b square divided by n times b over n, which in turn can be written as b cube over n cube multiplied by n times n plus 1 times 2n plus 1 divided by 6. Now, calculating the limit of this expression as n goes to infinity, we see that for very large n, this quantity can be made arbitrarily close to b cube divided by 3. So we can conclude that the upper Darboux sum, the upper Darboux integral of f, which is the infimum of the upper Darboux sums, is also equal than b cube over 3. Using the same regular partitions, we can also get that the lower Darboux sum of Fp, which can be written as the sum over all k from 1 to n, k minus 1 square, b square, divided by n square, b divided by n, which in turn is equal to b cube divided by n cube, times n minus 1, times n, times 2n minus 1, divided by 6, which again in the limit gets arbitrary close to b cube over 3, which allows us to conclude that the lower Darboux integral of f is greater or equal than b cube over 3. So the conclusion is that the lower Darboux sum is equal to the upper Darboux sum. So f is integrable. And the integral from 0 to b of f is equal to b cube over 3. So as you see, this is a intricate calculation, which in the future we would not, we would prefer not to do by hand, but rather we will prove some general theorems, well, in particular the fundamental theorem of calculus, which allows us to avoid doing all these complicated calculations by hand and rather apply some general general machinery. Yet another argument for developing this general machinery, even if you're interested in calculating some specific integrals. Let's consider one more example, 3. This time we consider the function f from ab to r, defined by f of x equal to 0 if x is a rational number, and equal to 1 if x is an irrational number. Then we claim that f is not integrable. So in particular, this shows that not all functions are integrable. To see this, suppose that we have some non-empty subinterval s contained in the interval ab. Then we have that the infimum of the values of f on this set is equal to 0, and the supremum of the values is equal to 1. This follows from the density of rational numbers as well as density of the irrational numbers. So on this interval we can find a rational number, hence the function takes value 0 on that point, and an irrational number we can also find inside s, hence the function takes value 1 on it. But then we have that for any partition P of the interval AB, we have that the lower Darboux sum with respect to this partition is equal to 0, and the upper Darboux sum with respect to this partition is equal to B minus A. So we can conclude that the lower Darboux integral of f is equal to 0, while the upper Darboux integral of f is equal to b minus a. And of course, 0 is less than b minus a. So these two integrals, the lower one and the upper one, are not equal. Hence, by definition, f is not integrable. Let us stop here for today. Thank you for your attention, and I'll see you next time.